I will give you a quick overview of our experience in charging infrastructure, on planning on this highly important topic for the uptake of electric mobility, of course. So I'm a founder and managing partner of Fiera Automotive, and we are working in e-mobility all over Europe, and both on light-duty vehicles, passenger cars, heavy-duty trucks, buses, but also a lot with governments, with European commissions. We are running portals for the European Commission on electric, on alternative fuels and electric mobility. So happy to share some of our experience with you. And I saw there are quite a bit of institutes today on board, and we think that you have a very important role to educate and to help assist the cities in realizing the charging infrastructure. So I will give you a snapshot of charging infrastructure planning, a little bit of this and that, all kind of things that we think is relevant. But every slide can be exploded in many other elements. So it's just a very quick overview. Importance of charging infrastructure, typologies of different types, technical specifications, interoperability, city planning, innovation trends. There's only one or two slides because we didn't have time for more for this session today. For open door, get the vehicle moving. Without charging, electric vehicle cannot drive. It's obvious. But it has to be sufficient available. So you have to be able to find it quickly. The power, the charging speed have to fit. This sounds like an open door, but please, it isn't. It is really a topic about where all the times there are mistakes made in reasoning what kind of kilowatts is the charger providing and what actually can the vehicle absorb. Also on street charging, so slow charging, 1, 2, 3 phase, different the amps. So it's really, it's something that comes quite close when planning. It has to be user friendly, so it has to be, the interaction has to be positive and provide satisfaction. It has to be reliable. We have gone through all the learning effects in Europe, and all the countries still do, where charges are there, are not working, are not interoperable. We'll go into this into a detail. Then the business case has to fit. So a business case where charging is very expensive doesn't help electric mobility uptake. And then again, the capacity utilization of the chargers won't be very high. So it's a good balance between the business case of for charging infrastructure providers and the electromobility market uptake, going hand in hand, of course. What are the main concerns that you see in EV drivers, and why is charging infrastructure important? It's a survey of McKinsey. If we do the same service in the Netherlands, in other European countries, we see the same elements. We see that the charging, lots of things are important, like the availability of vehicles, the cost of the vehicles and of the driving. But we see through the years, we see that the range and the availability of charging, how easy it is going up in importance relatively. And why is that? People have experienced that it's difficult. They see the vehicles are getting affordable. The new vehicles are getting more affordable compared to new petrol and the diesel cars. But the charging is often still a hassle. And then you have your range. You have to be certain that you can always reach your target. So important to have that have that in place and well functioning. When we look at the KPIs, the performance indicators for charging for the EV users, we see that first there has to be sufficient coverage. There has to be enough charges. When you go to visit friends, when you are at home, so the city, the local slow chargers has to be in place, as well as the fast chargers. And again, it's not only about sufficient coverage, but has to be at the right locations. It also has to be easy to operate. There can be a charger, but if you need to subscribe, before you can use it, or that you need a contract before you can use it, or you need to apply for a specific charge card, you cannot use your own, then there is actually no charger for you there available. So coverage is not just having the chargers there, but also being that it can be used by the people. Seamless charging is very much the same topic that you can internationally in Europe, many countries, very dense, populated, a lot of cross-border, you have to be able to do that easily. The roaming has to be the right assistance if it doesn't work. But also roaming in a country, even in the city, you have different networks where you want to use a different network. So roaming between the networks has to be seamless. Payment has to be transparent, so not that you get a bill at home, that you say, okay, this was pretty expensive, what happens? So it's not something, not a theoretically example, but it happens that suddenly you pay a lot and you think, okay, I could have filled my petrol tank for that twice or three times. You have to know in advance what you pay so that you can decide, do I want to charge or not? And the facilities, when you have a fast charger on the highway, is there a toilet? Is there, can you buy something to drink and to eat, for example? This is just some snapshots of the importance, of course, that the typology types. There is the highway charging, so we call it the opportunity charging down there. When you're driving to another location, you have the workplace charging, so that you with your car, you come at the parking place of the employer, and you can charge your car. Home charging, actually, the most important thing, even if it's home charging on your private premises, or that is home charging on the public domain, extremely important. And so there are different options, but also, of course, there are different vehicle types. Now, this I think this speaks for itself. You have taxi fleets, electric ones, heavy duty, and the waste collection fleets, your distribution vehicles, buses, fleets, all those need specific types of charges. You can often not mix it. You can create synergies, but you cannot combine the things. And taxis, different ways where you know the taxi has, the driver has to be certain that it doesn't reduce his business case of being able to pick up passengers, because then the electric vehicle gets very expensive for him. So there are different options. We won't go very much in detail, but some we will touch upon in this presentation. And of course, the different technologies, so from the pantographs, for the bus charging, for example, to the plug charging, the high power chip plug charging for the trucks. Going into the passenger vehicles, in the private fleet, looking at the different charging profiles, and all have their own specific characteristics. Like charging at home, most easy. Go driving, coming back home, putting the vehicle into the plugging the vehicle in, and in the morning it's full. All users that you ask after that have bought an electric car are so happy that they can do this so easily. Their car is always ready to go. And no hassle with thanks to the gasoline stations, just at home, cheap and lower electricity prices. Public area, if you don't have your own drive lane, your own parking space, you can park at the street. You should be very clear and very near to your home, so you don't have to walk miles from your vehicle to for the parking space. At night, you can combine it with public parking areas that are not in use at daytime, rapid charging in transit. This is on the highway, for example, all kinds of options. And each has its own business model, charging pattern, charging speed, the type of chargers, so CCS fast charging or also type 2 slow charging, for example. In all these typologies, the specifications and the interoperability is key. There are still a number of charging types over the world, so there's no standards worldwide in charging. But luckily, there is a standardization in the different regions nowadays. So at least that in Europe there is a standard. In North America there's a standard, and we are also quite happy that the European CCS 2 standard is quite well spread over the world for good reasons, often the technical capabilities. But what we really want to stress is it's not the vehicle manufacturer that defines the standard of their vehicle. In a region, the policymakers have to take in mind that it's their country, their region that sets the standards. So the vehicle manufacturers have to adapt to that. So not like some bus manufacturers that have their own plug types and create a lock-in. You can imagine that if you buy a charging infrastructure of a bus manufacturer with their own plug type, that if you buy next bus or with pantograph system or whatever specific ones, not interoperable, then if you buy your next fleet of buses, you can hardly avoid buying another and having to buy the same brand again because you are locked in. So this is important. Different solutions, different vehicle types. Here, overhead catenary charging, and here pantograph, the power track charging. Here you see the pantograph the charging, induction charging. Here, all kinds of new technologies are coming up. Some are very, very helpful. Catenary charging is still a little bit searching for, is this going to take off or not? It has good advantages, but it's also quite expensive. Pantograph charging for buses is definitely not going away. It's definitely a solution that's going to stay. Induction charging, we have to see what will happen with that. But most important is that you think ahead, where are you going to use, what's the application of the vehicles and the charging? And this is a business breaker or business maker, very important. And what can sound very logical is a bus, and what you often see is a bus company, even also same for truck companies, they want to have to replace their diesel vehicle one-on-one with an electric one. Meaning in the morning you charge, the vehicle drives around, and in the evening it gets charged again. That's most easy, but it's also quite expensive because the bus is expensive. If you have 1, 2, 3, 5 buses, 10 buses, it doesn't matter because then it's still probably the most cheap option. But if you're going to hundreds or thousands of buses in fleets, you know, the bus sizes can be pretty big in the large cities. Then the balance between the cost of the bus, the size of the battery, the charging infrastructure investments start to tip, and it's much better to have lots of opportunity charging on the way at the bus stops and have smaller batteries in the buses, making the investment tipping towards cheaper to invest in the charging infrastructure. When we speak about interoperability, back again a little bit, it's in all sectors, but let's go back to the passenger cars. A charger needs to be able to communicate with the vehicle. It's logical, but it's not like a plug at home where you put in your machine and it works. It's really there's communication between. This is the ISO standard, for example. There's the integration testing taking place between the vehicle and the charger, really very important. And this is developing all the time. So as a city, take care that your country follow the standards when you specify regulations or concessions. Then there is the communication between the charger and the back office, so the management system of the charger. Very important that this is via a well adapted standard. This is OCPP is now worldwide leading standards. It's developed in the Netherlands, but nowadays it's open protocol. So really the whole world is improving this protocol stepwise. But then there is from the charge, the system of the charges, charge point operator. A lot of communication taking place to do the payments, to do the services. You can see them here, OSPI and all kind of other protocols. Here is where still standards have to be defined a little bit more. We see OSPI being used pretty much as standard for communication on the payment. And here, where you can see back into the energy system, standards are less mature. So where you can, in fact, especially when you want to start do smart charging and vehicle to grid, we'll come back to that later on. It's important that the whole system works with the same standardization, so you can really also start from a public interest, start to steer the charging and electricity use, but will really help you with the investment cost. And many stakeholders, you see energy supplier, you see the charge point infrastructure, and the manufacturer, so the one who manufactures the charging infrastructure, the charge poles. Then the charge point operators, so the one who owns the network, the one who sells the electricity to the user. The host sometimes is located, for example, at a gasoline station. There are some charges from a charge point operator. Then there is the roaming possibility, where you can roam across the network, where you can use your one subscription to charge at different locations and the mobility service provider. So lots of actors, and again, communication is key, because it might sometimes, you will see that, you saw that also in Europe, might sometimes seem interesting for those actors to create a sort of monopoly. And this is a public importance to take care. This is an open market where the user is the end user. Companies, either company user or a private user, are central. Here you see on the left side of the slide, you see lots of logos. This is logos of charge cards. Right-hand picture, you see that there are some examples of these charge cards where you can charge, you activate the charger with. You don't want this situation. You want to make it very easy for the user to charge with one subscription, with one card everywhere, or even ad hoc with his payment card attached to every charger. Because this creates confusion, creates lock-in, this creates irritation at the charger, for the EV user, and limits the uptake. To summarize, what is then the interoperability? So the interoperability ability of the vehicle's chargers, network, and management systems to interact and manage data to ensure safety, they can charge safe, compatible, the compatibility of equipment and protocols, functional is always work and is reliable, and that the system is always available. So the vehicle, the power supply, the energy management, the operator, the back office provider, the back office, the CPO, the charger connectivity, and the hardware needs to all interact seamlessly. It sounds like an open door. Please take in mind this can be pretty much a nightmare, and think ahead. For this. So many countries like the US, also European countries, have lots of experience with this. So there is no reason to make the same mistakes that we made. It's important. And also, when I mentioned the US, so please take in mind the first situation there, where you could have five different chargers next to each other. You needed, depending on which subscription you had, you could use one of them. That's a situation that you don't want. Because in the end, the society pays for the grid connection, because there can be the situation that five vehicles charge in parallel and are not able to discharge smart, because it's not allowed. You don't have access to that as society. You have to increase the grid connection. So in the end, the society pays for these things. So it's important to think ahead and to take care that you are in control as a city, as a public authority. City planning. What's often used in Europe is a charging ladder. First priority is always, can a user charge his vehicle at his own premises? It's cheapest for society if you can just, when somebody can realize a charger at their own land, at their own territory, and invest for it themselves. Also, the cheapest solution to realize. Second is, can you do it close to the home or the company in public space, but connected to the private grid of the household or of the business? That can also be a pretty economic solution. Then in public space, on the public grid, that's the next priority level. And then but also being semi-public, so that's also open for wider public, but located closer to the homes. And then public recharging, so really in the public domain can also be fast charging. And here's also, you see the right side, you see how much influence the authorities have on the, with their policy. What we normally recommend is to do this, the planning of a charger in a city via a layered approach, so the strategic planning. To look, for example, at what kind of chargers are already in place, are already installed. What's the current capacity utilization? Are there one where they are not used and there should be others located nearby? What are the new requests from inhabitants? The regulation in the Netherlands and other European countries is that if you have a vehicle, electric vehicle, then normally the city is obligated to provide a solution for charging. If you have, do not have your own drive lane next to your house, and that has to be in a number of meters from your home, realize so maximum 300-400 meters walking. And of course, for the charging itself, you have to pay. Normally, it's a commercial company realizing the charges, but the space has to be provided. The traffic flows. What are the big traffic flows through the city so that you can try to create synergies with vehicles passing by? What are parking locations where you can maybe at night use them for charging of inhabitants and daytime commercial parking space? What are the expected EV uptake patterns? So where are the neighborhoods, people living where you expect the quickest uptake? So higher income levels, higher education levels, we normally see where that's the quickest uptake of electric mobilities. And there you would like to cluster already the first investments on chargers. Stakeholders to cooperate with, supermarkets, amusement parks, or whatever, where you can, where they can make a business daytime with chargers, and at nighttime you can help the inhabitants of your city can do the overnight charging and parking. Grid map, where are the limitations? Other relevant factors, is there a mobility hub? Are there metro stations, subway stations, for example, with a lot of power, where you can quite cheap realize the charging infrastructure? And most important, follow a hands-on approach. Go out and look. It's not only mapping and strategic planning, but it's also looking at the location. Okay, this would be a superb spot. But then the first planning you do on a higher level. Work with a utility company on the grid, what I also already mentioned. Combine it with high power sources of electricity sources, like e-bus depot, for example, or subway metro grid. And try to make smart combinations, also explained. So, for example, this is mobility hubs where you can have where the train and the buses are, the station is, where you can have a taxi station, but where you can also have for example, shared vehicles being charged. So, try to combine it. Very important as a city, this one, take care that you have the right monitoring. So, it's really the city is in control. So that you know how many charging sessions, or how many users, so that you can steer as a city also where you, not only from an investment side, but also from an urban planning side, where you want to stimulate the uptake of electromobility more and where you would like to have more chargers. This is an example of a fast charging station, but can also be in a city, for example, can be on the highway. Go over this. When you go into planning, and this is run very quickly over this slide, but if you go into the planning of charging infrastructure, please take in mind that there are a number of costs. There's one-time costs. You have the electricity network, grid connection, transformer, power cabinet, charging point. All those things you need to invest, the investments are needed. These can be pretty high. But also the recurring cost can be pretty high, depending on the way a country calculates the recurring cost, yearly cost. So is there a peak capacity rate, for example, service and maintenance. And this can also pretty much define what kind of charging infrastructure you would like to realize in the city and what you can realize. And if it's useful to do the fastest charging possibility or not. When you go into the planning, it's already important to think ahead about the parking charging utilization policy. We have, again, try to avoid the mistakes that we made, making ghost chargers, I would call them. They are realized somewhere but never used. But charges also for public acceptance need to be used because you're taking away parking spots from petrol cars often. And the owner of the petrol car might not like that, especially not when the parking spot for the electric vehicles all the time empty because nobody's using it. So it's also for the acceptance quite important. But having a high occupancy rate, high capacity utilization rate is important because it reduces the use of public space. Otherwise, you need more charging parking locations, reduced installation maintenance costs and investment costs, pretty important. And again, the acceptance, I would say, is even the most important that we see. We see situations where people are really annoyed when they know that was their parking spot. It's not theirs, public, but they were theirs, but they thought it was they used it every day. And now there's the city says, I'm going to plan a charger right there. And then you see people scratching on the cars because they are a little bit angry that they can no longer park their vehicles there. So really the acceptance is important. And then also the restrictions on the use of EV parking lots. We'll come back to that in a second. Different parking rates. So for example, you can say the parking lots can only be used while recharging the vehicle. Can be used whatever. That was the early situation in many European countries. If you had an electric car, even if you didn't charge, you could use the charging spot for the electric vehicle. That's no longer the case because there are too many electric vehicles and too few chargers. So now you can only use it when you're actually charging at most locations. And otherwise it can be towed away, for example. I can also say it's open for charging of EVs during daytime, for example, and in nighttime it's open for everybody. Can be very specific situations. We see that in Germany quite a bit. I think it's not optimal, but of course, if there is a pressure on the parking space, it can be a solution. It can be different parking rates, so it's free parking. That's often a nice trigger in the early days of electromobility. You can do free parking. You can even offer the from a city. It's quite cheap. Okay, you can also do free charging in the first year, for example, first 2 years of your market pickup, or 5 years, whatever, how quick it goes. That can be quite interesting driver. What Amsterdam did, they said, in the early days, if you have a vehicle, then you have a guaranteed electric vehicle, they have a guaranteed parking spot where parking is a nuisance in Amsterdam. So you also have search for parking spots, even if you have paid allowance for parking during the year, parking permit, then still you have to search. But if you had an electric car, you had them in front of your house, and it was for you. So this was a real driver for fast EV uptake. But it can only be temporary, you can imagine. Regular parking rates, so you have to pay normally. That's not, and you can also do progressive parking rates. You can also do the bit electricity prices or the different ways. You say if you park longer than 3 hours, then your car should be full, and then you start to pay more for parking and charging. This is the Amsterdam example, what I just explained. Quickly, two snapshots about innovation opportunities. I already highlighted the high investment cost of grid investments, so the electricity grid to create sufficient power for the chargers. This is even if the grid on national level in many countries is sufficient, you always will see problems in neighborhoods on local level, at least on city level. But you can turn it around. You can say, no, I see this charging as an opportunity instead of an extra cost. First, by smart charging, you can reduce the charging to moments that there is not so much demand. So the vehicles are charged, for example, in the middle of the day when there is less demand in some, depending on the characteristics of your electricity use in the country, but this is a case in the Netherlands, for example. But peak times, morning, early morning, evening, when all the microwaves and everybody starts to cook and heating gets higher, you don't want the vehicles to charge. So you reduce that already. And the next step is that you say, let's start to have the vehicles, the batteries used, so that they power back into the grid, the vehicle to grid. And you can imagine that if you start to do this, so that you charge the vehicle on the moment, for example, when there is enough enough power, or even better, when there is enough wind power or solar power, that you're improving also the business case for your renewables. Because your renewables, when there is too much on a certain part of the day, they are not have to be stopped, so the windmills have not to be deactivated for some time if there's really too much power. But you can really use this power and put it into the vehicle. So it's flattening the curve, it's flattening the energy use, and it's really a driver for EV uptake and for EV for reducing the cost of e-mobility, so what you drive for EV uptake, but also a driver for the renewable energies. So this is something to really look into. Another thing that I would like to highlight is that the country, the city, is in control. So with regulation and also with public procurement, you define what you want in your city. If you don't do anything, then you will have lots of different charge point operators with a different design charges. Do you want as a city? Maybe that's fine, that's not good. If you want to have charging done in not on the street, this is the, but if you want to have parking, not of the street, but in parking garages in general, this is the time to act, because you can start to steer towards charging in parking garages, for example, instead of on the street, if you would like that. That's depending on your city policy. But also, if you want interoperability, if you want to be to have seamless use of the user throughout the city, different network, maybe different cities, so you can all roam freely. Where you have the cost in control, you can put in the tenders, you can specify what the maximum prices are, or you can tender based on the lowest price for electricity. This is your moment to be in control and to define what you want from your charging system. And to work together with the commercial sector to realize this. The worst thing what can happen is that it's still small, as you say, we leave it up to the market and they will define, because then you will get a patchwork of different solutions not being interoperable. So this is my presentation. Thank you.